one of our friends and new friends. Some of you were here last year, and so thank you for coming back. It's a real honor to serve you. I've been home this week, and it's been great to get to visit with everybody here. We've had a farm forum, and we talked about the farm bill, and that was really good. The small business roundtable up in Sedalia, and then we're having a few town halls today. We've been to Buffalo, and then we're going to California afterwards. So I'm so glad so many of you were able to come. I thought I would just start off with just sharing just a little bit of some of the things going on in Washington. I don't want to take a lot of time, 10, 15 minutes. I got a few slides. Can you guys see that on the great background? It's a little awkward, but anyway, we'll run through those pretty quick. And then I'm going to spend most of the time just visiting, listening to you and hearing what you have to say, what's on your mind, what concerns you may have, and how I might be helpful. So, I am on the Armed Services Committee and the Agriculture Committee, and I feel very honored to represent you and to stand strong for you on those committees. The Ag Committee, there's only four of us that actually still live on a working farm, and some report in D.C. said that's out of the 435 in the House of Representatives, there's only four. And I'm not sure if that's right or not, but I know there's fewer and fewer people there that have a direct knowledge of what goes on in rural America. And that's very concerning. So I, being a lifelong farmer, feel very strongly about fighting for you and making sure that rural America stays strong. And I know the FSA office proposed closing here is something that's on a lot of your minds, and it's been very concerning to me. Just want to let you know, if you haven't heard already, you know, I have my office has called multiple times. We've been in touch with the USD office, but I sent a personal letter to Secretary of Agriculture Tom Vilsack. I encourage him to relook at that, asking for a lot of information to rationalize why he would be doing this, and haven't heard back yet from him from the letter, which is very disappointing. I've also co-signed onto a bill sponsored by Representative Christy Noem, which says that they can't close an FSA office if it is within 20 miles. The 20 miles has to be driving distance, not as the crow flies, because that's what's a problem here. I think you're technically 19.9 or something, almost 20 miles from the nearest FSA office. But if you drive it, you know, it's a lot farther than that. And certainly it's going to be a hardship for the farmers' community. So anyway, we've been working on that. And as you know, I've been working on Lake Ozarks issues. Unbelievable. Last year, what's transpired between when I was here last year and what's happened this year. Who would have thought a federal agency would order the removal of 1,200 homes in our district? Unbelievable. Talk about an overreach by federal bureaucracy. And as you know, as soon as we found out about this, and worked with many of you here, but we introduced a bill requiring that FERC cannot do that. And it was that bipartisan support. Every Missouri representative signed on to that bill. We had bipartisan support in the Senate. Both senators introduced the same bill. I went to the House floor and spoke for 5 minutes, a 5-minute speech, railing against this whole action. We tried to bring as much attention to it as possible, and thankfully, FERC has backed off of that, and they said, oh, okay, you don't have to remove it. But there are ongoing issues with this whole thing, and I know some of you are still involved in those on a personal basis. You still have a home right there. And there's property rights issues at stake here. There's a lot at stake. I am looking at very close to finalizing a new bill to introduce that would take allow states to opt out of FERC's regulation of anything other than power generation. To me, it just makes sense. Why should the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission have any say over anything other than energy? Why should they have a say about the recreation or wildlife or habitats or these other aspects of lake life that have nothing to do with power generation? So we've been trying to refine the language and get it just right, but we're going to be probably moving forward with that. And I hope that we can get this through so that down the road you don't ever have this happen again. And one federal government agency come and try to impose their will on us. So anyway, those are a couple of local issues. But just as far as a few other things here, I'll run through these real quick. These are kind of the hot topic items. Federal spending, overspending is still foremost in my mind and certainly a priority that we've got to quit spending money we don't have. Now, you and I don't do it at home. But for the people who weren't able to come last year, just kind of a very interesting review of where our money goes and kind of understand where we're at. These two categories here are the only two categories that Congress really votes on and appropriates every year. The other categories are mandatory spending. They're programs that Congresses in the years past have okayed, and they're just they're ongoing. So the money just automatically flows out of those. But this is non-fiscal discretionary would be everything, mostly I would consider federal government, all your departments, Department of Labor, Department of Transportation, Health and Human Services, etc. Congress, foreign aid, all of that would be in here. And then this, of course, is defense. And like I said, I'm very, very strong on national defense. My dad is in the Army Reserves, and I know there's some veterans here. I can't tell you how privileged I feel to sit on Armed Services Committee and to fight for our men and women in uniform to make sure that they have the tools they need to keep our country strong. And according to the Constitution, there's only a few things Congress should be doing, and that one of them is to provide for the common defense. So as I oppose and have been a strong opponent of a lot of the cuts coming to defense that have been proposed from the President, people say, well, you know, don't you want to cut? And I said, well, we do need to live within our means, but we got to get our priorities straight as a country. And the priority is to provide the common defense. Where we're at on the fifth spending, the Budget Control Act, or the debt ceiling deal, whatever you call it, that passed last August. And by the way, I voted no on that, just a reminder. But one reason I voted no is because it automatically cut defense $487 billion over the next 10 years. So those are already in effect. Then it set up a super committee, and the super committee was supposed to cover $1.2 trillion worth of cuts. If they were unsuccessful, then something called sequestration was supposed to take place, which is another automatic cut of additional $500 billion. So you put those two together, that's almost $1 trillion cut out of this piece of the pie. So there you can keep trying to balance the back of the budget on the backs of our military, and it's unacceptable. And so we're trying to reverse that sequestration from taking place, because it's going to hollow out our forces, according to Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta. So that's something I'd be happy to share more about if you want to go more in depth with that. But of course, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, this says net interest on the debt, which of course it just goes out automatically. That's kind of a concerning area to me, though, because our interest rates now are pretty high or low. Yeah, they're pretty low, and so if our interest rates go up, you can see what that's going to do to that piece of the pie. It's going to consume an even larger percentage of our budget and squeeze out less from the other areas. The other mandatory areas are just several programs that Congress has passed in years ago that basically say if a citizen qualifies, they're going to get XYZ dollars. So in that, they have Pell Grants, unemployment benefits, welfare, farm subsidies, all of it. So that's kind of the areas. Now, I asked my staff to take these categories and put them in a bar graph form and then compare it to revenue. And we have a really great staff, we as the 4th District that work through, and they did. So here's the same thing, they're different colors. We haven't got that sophisticated yet. We'll work on the color coding, but anyway. Same things. But here's how much money came in. This is 2010. When we did this a month or two ago, we didn't have the 2011 numbers yet. But you can compare and see how much money came in. So yes, there was money that came in for Social Security, money that went out. But you see, not last year, 2010, what we passed a threshold in our country. For the first time, more money is now going out of Social Security than is coming in. So that's expected to continue. time because the baby boomers were getting older as a country. So what's happened before that, more money was coming in and going out, and so the Social Security trustees took that extra money and invested it, kind of like a CD, but they bought T-bills and treasury bonds from the government with it. In exchange, they got a piece of paper like a CD that would says we owe you X amount, and here's how much interest we're going to pay. They tell me there actually is a file cabinet somewhere in Washington, D.C. with all these IOUs, these papers from Social Security. I don't know, but anyway. So last year, 2010, for the first time, the trustees have started to cash in their IOUs, and the federal government has been paying back with interest. But that's only going to last so long, and then the file cabinet will run out, and then we'll have a little deficit. So that's why you're hearing the talk about the trustees should make some reforms to Social Security now, before we get to that point, to make sure it remains fiscally solid for years to come. But there's been no specific proposal put out there, and so if you hear that Congress is trying to do away with Social Security and all that, that's just not true. The Medicare is a lot greater deficit. This is how much came in, how much going out. The average American couple, they say, pays in about $110,000 over their lifetime to Medicare. But the problem is the average American couple now is receiving $330,000 from the benefits. And there's several reasons for that, but certainly health care costs are going up. It's just costing a lot more. So this is a real problem. And Medicare is a very, very important program to many of our seniors. And last year and this year, we put forth a proposal, a suggestion, a way to strengthen, preserve, and protect this program to make sure it doesn't go bankrupt. Right now, they're saying Part A is supposed to go bankrupt about 8 years. The CBO says that. So we can keep kicking the can down the road and politicizing it, or we can do the right thing and start talking about what can we do to reduce costs but yet preserve this program. And so we came forward with an idea, and I'd be happy to share more about it if you want to know more, but I'm open to ideas. I just think it's an important program that we need to protect, and so we need to start talking about it. This is how much we paid April 15th, woohoo! That's our part, income tax. Here's how much corporate tax, other, and excise tax. But you can see there's a problem there, right? I mean, the money that came in didn't equal the money going out. And so that's why we have to borrow the money. It equals about $4 billion a day. So basically, we got a choice. We need to increase the revenue, or we need to decrease over here. It's just common sense. I know many of you are businessmen or women, and certainly bounce a budget at home. You understand that. One of the concerns with having so much debt, of course we're almost at $16 trillion now, is who owns our foreign part of their debt. About 49% of our total debt is owned by foreign countries. Of that, 29% is owned by China, which is very concerning. With the interest that we pay China just on the debt, China can afford to buy 3 new Joint Strike Fighters a week and still have $50 million left over. And we know they are building up their military. They introduced their own version of aircraft carrier busting bomb last year. They introduced their own version of a stealth fighter. It's concerning. So, if we didn't have any other motivation to get out of debt as a country, this motivates me. So what's the solution? Oh, let's get to a balanced budget. Radical idea. It needs to happen. So in the House, we've done it a couple ways. We passed a balanced budget amendment. Well, I say we passed. We voted on a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution. 49 states have some version of a balanced budget amendment to their Constitution. Missouri does. But we don't at the federal level. So we tried to pass one. In order to change the Constitution, you probably remember from 8th grade social studies class, that you have to have a two-thirds vote in the House, in the Senate, and then it goes out to the states, and three-fourths of the state legislatures have to ratify it. Anyway, we came 5 votes shy of getting the two-thirds we needed in the House. So I was disappointed in that, but we're going to keep trying. We may vote on it again. We're going to keep working for it. But the other thing we did is just passed a budget that balances on our own. And we think that's important. This is the budget that we passed last year, this year. It does get us to a balanced budget, but not till 2050. The reason is we're spending all this money on all these programs to immediately cut off that 40% would be major disruption in a lot of people's lives. So we're making some changes to get us to a balanced budget, but this is the president's budget. It never balances at all, and it, frankly, I think it's going to bankrupt our country. So I did note this line represents a more aggressive budget put forward by some of the more the conservative caucus in the House, and I'm a member of the Republican Study Committee, which we tend to be more fiscally conservative. And we found a way to do it in 5 years, and we didn't get quite enough votes to pass, but I'm certainly advocating for that. But either way, we've got to get to a balanced budget. Another way to do it, though, is to increase revenues. You know, not just all through cuts, let's raise the revenue and we'll balance the budget. Two ways being talked about in Washington to do that. One is to raise taxes. The other is to create more jobs. I'm on the let's create jobs side. I think that's the best way we can do that. We passed multiple bills, at least 28 of them are stuck over in the Senate, to try to remove the barriers to job creation that are keeping business owners from expanding and hiring more people. And let's say the Senate just is not, won't vote on it. So that's been really frustrating. I also held a small business conference up at the University of Central Missouri, and it was attended by over 300 entrepreneurs and business owners who wanted to learn how to grow their business, how to expand it. We had four different panels of experts on all kinds of topics, from how to finance your business, to how to use social media to market your business. It was great. So hopefully that'll help. And then we had a jobs fair in Lebanon, I guess a month or so ago, and that was a success. It was so much fun. We had 29 companies from the area come in who are hiring. First of all, that's encouraging to know they are hiring. And then we had over 100 job seekers come and visit with them. We went around that day and visited with businesses, and they said if they could that day, if they met the right people, they would hire a total of 223 people. So there are jobs out there. And at the end of the day, we found out some people were actually hired. So that made me feel good. So we're trying to help people find jobs both in D.C. through policy and then just practical things. And the last hot topic, obviously, is gas prices. My staff found this slide. I thought it was funny. Sad, true, you know, you got the arm, the leg, the first board. I mean, it's just crazy. I mean, prices have more than doubled under the president since he's took office. And Missouri's average price is $3.74. Now, that was a few weeks ago we made the slide, but it may be a little bit more, but it's still unacceptable. It's very hard, especially since there's solutions. We need to increase the supply of oil that we have here so we're not so dependent on foreign countries. It's not that hard. The Keystone Pipeline is a very simple, common sense project, shovel ready, 20,000 jobs, ready to go. And the president blocked it. There's bills that we passed to encourage the administration to give them permits. Let's start drilling again offshore. Let's drill in the untapped oil reserves here in America. You know, we're the Saudi Arabia of coal and natural gas. Let's use it. Quit trying to stop it through the regulations of the EPA. We need to be using nuclear. It takes 10 to 15 years to build a nuclear power plant. Let's get those permits going. France is almost totally powered through safe nuclear, and it can be done. So there are solutions, but it's frustrating, and most of them are being blocked by the Senate and the White House, frankly. But I'm still fighting. I'm trying to advance those things I hear from you all that you want, and we're going to continue to do that. So I think we're ready for listen to you. So let's turn the lights up and let's hear what you have. What's on your mind? What common sense advice you want to share with me to take back? Yes.
I'm Carl Payne. I'm an independent. Are you looking at the 20th? And I'm sure you read with the scathing Kansas City Star article here last January. Well, it mentioned
probably.
In 10 years, you were received over $974,000 in crop subsidies.
Thanks that much. But anyway, go ahead.
That would help reduce the deficit, wouldn't it? Eliminate the crop subsidies.
Yeah. Let me update you on that. That's a farm bill topic, and it's very much a hot topic we're discussing right now in agriculture. And I just tell you, direct subsidies are probably good.
And how about the $824 billion that we spent in Iraq? George W. Bush's war? We could be using that money in this country.
Yeah, well, if you didn't know, we're...
We have to destroy Iraq to save. Would you agree to that?
Well, if you didn't know, we're out of Iraq, and that money's not going there anymore. I'm two for two here.
We're still sending money to Iraq to support the government, pay off the tribal leaders.
You're right, probably still is some going that way. But obviously, this happened before I got there, and, but we are mostly out of Iraq now, and we're pulling out of Afghanistan, so.
Star said that you worth between $3.5 and $15 million, is that correct?
I question those figures, because what they're looking at is the personal financial disclosure forms, and we have to put how much debt we have. And we own 3 farm equipment dealerships. Do you know how much a combine costs?
Maybe.
Okay, so we've got a few of those on our lot. And so we have to hold all that inventory, and as a business owner, we own our buildings and stuff. So that is reflected in, how much, but it's not like I have $1 million in the bank. I'd have to sell the buildings and sell all my combines. By the way, you guys all want to come on in. So that's part of being a business owner, is that you have an investment. It's called an investment, but it's also called debt. And that's not reflected. So those reports are written by people who don't like me, who don't want me reelected. They're here. We've got people who follow me around. They take my pictures. They're video recording me so they can defeat me this November. Anyway, that's part of it. So, but it's out there. And
one more question.
All right.
Can you introduce a bill to eliminate crop subsidies? That will help the deficit.
Well, I'm on the Ag Committee, and I'll probably be voting on that the next month, so you can follow my votes.
Statute that requires that a budget be passed every year. I understand that Harry Reid has sat on it for 3 years. There is no budget. How is he allowed to break the law?
That is a good question. That is what I've asked myself.
I would be in jail.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay, and so would you. Okay, how is he allowed not to do that?
I don't believe there's a penalty. I mean, that's in the Constitution, and it's where we have to, as American people. It's called election. Just unelect them if you don't like the way they're performing. So you can unelect me if you don't like me.
Amen to that.
Okay. All right. What else? Yes, sir.
I was reading about that a week or so ago that you were talking to another congressperson about base loans.
Oh yeah, sure.
My daughter sat down on Charleston, it's close down there. That has a pretty much
communities. Yes, it is.
Then Representative Ron Paul told me we have over 900 military installations and over 950. My question is, where should we be closing?
It is a big issue. He's asking about base closings, and I'm opposed to another brag. And here's why. We have in 2005 was the last brag. It cost between $37 and $39 billion to close down the bases they closed, and that's not expected to even break even in savings till 2018. So when we have limited dollars now, limited defense dollars, why should we be spending them on closing bases when, in fact, that's our national priority? Even with the drawdowns that are coming, we're still going to have more troops on the ground here than before 9/11. So they're going to need a place to stay. They're going to need a place to operate out of. So I oppose it. We're going to probably get it stopped in the House Armed Services Committee. But I did meet with Secretary Leon Panetta, to your point, and about the BRACs, and we questioned about the bases overseas and said, what about them, you know, before you even look here? And he informed us, which I didn't know, that they'd already closed many, many bases. It seemed like he said 100, but I have to go check my notes. 100 bases overseas, and that the Army was going to be closing at least another 30, I believe, overseas. So I was pleased to hear that they are looking abroad at doing that rather than here.
They got the bases in Germany.
Yeah.
There were 52% of people old in Germany by American units.
Mm.
And do you know what the Okinawa say when they say Yankee go home?
It's probably not good. Yeah. So I think you're right.
And they're moving back into the Philippines, too. I'm sure you're aware of that.
Anyway, we're trying to make sure we keep defense as a priority. I don't support the BRACs, and we are in fact I've called for a statewide group to be formed here in Missouri to strengthen our defense footprint in the event there should be an attack. We've had a meeting already with all the different installations in the state, Whiteman Air Force Base and Fort Leonard Wood and Rosecrans and others, and talking about what we can do. Several states have an ongoing statewide organization that advocates for the defense industry in their state. We don't really have as big of a group like that that we should, but we're in the process, so hopefully we'll be a good stead should that happen. Yes, sir.
Hi, David here. I got to meet with you a couple of weeks ago. I went to Washington with the Dental Association. One of the things that we were very concerned about was there are four major tax increases coming by January 1st. They will expire on the 31st. We've got the minimum tax, we've got the...
There's a lot more than that. Yeah,
there's four major ones going. And basically, the Senate is not talking to each other at all. So this is going to be decided by the lame duck session, where hopefully a third of them will be going home. Okay? Are we making any progress at all with the Senate to pass any of this legislation that needs to be done before the election?
Unfortunately, they aren't wanting to do hardly anything until the election, and I haven't heard any movement in that. I think the House is going to be putting forward a program for a proposal for tax reform that, you know, whether it's going to go anywhere or not is another story. So it's not right. There's a whole bunch of things that are coming to this kind of a perfect storm, only not a perfect storm, but a bad, imperfect storm. After the lame duck session, not only the taxes, but a lot of programs are expiring, and it's very concerning. It's the wrong way to do things. Plus, you're going to have a lot of decisions made from people who may not even have been reelected, you know, aren't really accountable. So it's very concerning. Yes?
Two simple questions. My name is Fred Allison. About Lake of the Ozarks, all the articles I've read, and I've read a lot of articles, what is their main objective to the shoreline, to the level of the 660 mark? What I never have seen what their problem is with tearing out everything at the 660. That's number one. And second question, really simple question. Legally, how does Harry Reid have the right to shelve something the House voted on and passed? What's the legal?
Well, there's no
legally,
provision.
How's he able to do that?
Well, because there's no requirement that you have to take that.
Okay, there's something in. I don't know how that would work.
Yeah, so when I was in the Missouri House, you know, we would pass a lot of bills, and the Senate may or may not choose to take that up. But you would hope, if it's the will of the people enough that it got support in one House, usually that encourages the other House. It's enough of an important issue that they will take it up. You have to talk to Aaron about the rationale, 660 versus 662 and all of that. My staff has looked into some of that, and I can't tell you off the top of my head all those rationales on the direct original easements and things. So, yeah.
How do we get a handle on these bills that start out good and then just go haywire? This bill on the left, I'm not educated, some of these folks in this panel here that's concerned about supplementing our farmers and feed us all. So the bill that came out that poor people would have a landline, a telephone, everyone would have it. and I understand that, calling 911 letters. And now people are getting cell phones, 4 or 5 cell phones a family through this bill, and it's amounting to $1 billion. I don't see the need for that.
No.
Before I subsidize people with their cell phone, I don't mind subsidizing our meat and grain producers.
Yes. You know, I heard about that. Originally, a constituent sent me an email about that, and I'm like, you're kidding, we're not giving free cell phones. And then I looked into it, and there is a provision for the free cell phones. It's unbelievable. From the Universal Service Fund. Yeah, go sign up. Yeah, so there's some legislation that's been introduced to stop that, and you know, we'll see where it goes, but it's crazy.
Do you know anything about the declaratory judgment that our miniscule got on the spot payments here? I know that's fairly recent.
The miniscule what? EU?
A declaratory judgment by UV against light property owners. Do you know anything at all about it? It's fairly recent, so I...
Yes, I don't think so. I don't think so. Like, we've had so many different lake issues that we're dealing with. I may not have heard of that recently, so let me know. Get that to me.
I have a question.
All right.
Do you know whether or not Cameron is contributing to Barack Obama and Clinton Castle's campaigns through their super PACs or whatever?
No, I mean, you've done that. You go to the Federal Election Commission website, and you know, it's, you can look it up. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
I've got a number of comments. We hear a lot of stuff about Medicare and Social Security going in the ditch.
Yeah.
$75 to $100 billion a year goes to Medicare fraud. Here just recently, a couple of days ago, they caught a ring in Florida that was worth $80 million. Chump change.
Wow.
Once every 6 months or so, we hear where the federal government prosecutes somebody for Medicare fraud. Mm-hmm. That's just the tip of the iceberg. If we could capture that $100 million going to $100 billion going to the crooks of the year, it would go a long way towards keeping Medicare solvent. I think there ought to be some prosecutors, attorneys, judges, whatever, hired for $1 billion a year. We'd still come out ahead if we close these doggone drug rings down. Social Security. Virtually every CBO official, actuary, economist says the easy solution to Social Security is to raise the tax, sitting at $106,000 a year right now. Percentage-wise, the caps have gone up nowhere near the total wealth of this country over the last 40 or 50 years. It seems to me that the easy solution for Social Security, at least in the short term, is to get those caps up. That's something that needs to be worked on. We've got hundreds of millions of people in this country that are going to be counting on these programs in the future. All we're doing is we're taking money from our kids, and they'll have nothing 20 or 30 years from now. We are creating problems for our kids and grandkids and everything that Washington does. I'm okay, but those coming behind me 20 or 30 years from now are going to be in dire straits because of the stupidity going on today. Then,
that's great. Let's give him a hand.
All we can see out of Washington, blame the other guy, push the problems down the road. Don't Democrats and Republicans talk to each other anymore?
No.
I've heard good and bad ideas come out of both parties, but it seems like all we can do anymore is Democrats good, Republicans bad, or vice versa. And that's where the conversation sucks. It's no wonder Congress has a 9% approval rating. Then, the stupidest thing that has happened in my recent lifetime was starting 2 wars and initiating tax cuts at the same time. During World War II, this country ran up a massive debt.
12 votes for and 111 passes, two-thirds support. It was passed under suspension, which you have to have two-thirds vote to get it through. And I was a little concerned whether we could do that, but we did. So I very much appreciate it. Worked with Representative Acosta from California, who's a Democrat, who had an aspect of the bill that he wanted to help his utilities in California, same type of provisions as our rural electric cooperatives. I said, sure. So, you know, I want you to know, you hear about a lot of the things that aren't working, but there is still some things I'm certainly happy to work with everybody to get done what needs to be done for the American people. So I think we'll keep doing that. Yes, Tom?
You had a chart up there with all the taxes on it. What about all the hidden taxes? FERC gets all its funding from AMLIN.
Oh.
Who pays AMLIN? People who use the electricity,
right,
pays,
yeah,
AMLIN. So that's a tax that we don't even see.
Sure, there's a lot of taxes.
I mean, they don't even, we don't even know what their FERC's budget is, how much money they're getting from AMLIN to do what they're doing with this.
I would think it'd be public record, but that's something I don't know off the top of my head, but that's, I hear your point.
I mean, if you didn't have that,
yeah,
there's lots of hidden taxes in this country.
Yes.
I was curious what Congress's attitude is to the space program. I don't know, I'm old enough to remember why we went into space, and that's to keep the Russians from putting missiles up there, that was, we had no defense. What this president has done has taken that defense down. We're wide open. We don't have a way to go up into space now and knock out a missile satellite that's sitting up there. Is Congress at all interested in space? They've got this goofy green thing out of space now, and it's the biggest fraud in the country, actually the world. You know, liberals won't follow facts. You can't give a fact to a liberal. It's their feelings. But it's been discredited that East Anglia University, where they marked up all the data, that's what they were basing this on. But long story. Is Congress, what's their attitude toward space? I feel this president is giving Russia our missile defense information. I mean, whatever we got, he's giving it to them. Now he's sitting over there in a powwow with them. And so he's totally disarming us. We've got Iran over there with a 3,000 mile missile that can hit this country. We're totally defenseless. And I don't know if anybody worries about that. I do. You don't need many nuclear weapons hit this country, and you'll wipe out half the country.
Very, very concerning. I'm a big supporter of missile defense, and I have a lot of concerns with Russia, too, and what they're doing. As far as attitudes toward space, I'm not on those specific committees that oversee NASA, but one of my colleagues represents NASA, and he was expressing some of the concerns with the jobs that have been lost in their area due to the cuts. And the technology that is able to be gained from the space exploration, I mean, the simple things even like Corningware, yeah, you know, came from that, but there's a lot more than that.
Well,
the benefit of private industry from that and public investment. So I think there is an appreciation and respect for it.
They justify it on all the side effects of that development. But the primary reason was for missile defense and satellite defense. Nobody's concerned,
yeah,
about that.
I'll be happy to look into
we
that.
We cannot go up and knock a satellite out right now.
I've never heard that in our services yet, though, that
we have
the ability to take them out.
We can't take them out.
So,
One other thing.
Okay.
So I want to dominate. But I'm just about to blow my cork with this communist regime that we've got in Washington. And at Harry Reid, I have no idea what those people are doing. But I did have one
nothing.
Time.
The answer is nothing, just like.
Well, I think people better decide that we were either going to be a communist country or not. But that isn't what I'm talking about. I had an opportunity in years past history at a consulting firm. And we worked with the Defense Department. And we were in the Pentagon, the Joint Chiefs and all that. I tell you this, and I'll stick my, you could give every government employee an even or odd number, and you tell the odd ones to go home and don't show up, and I guarantee you, you will not miss them at all. Those people, those bureaucrats that we pay these high salaries, are beyond incompetent. And we as a contractor had to do their work for them so that we could get our contracts through. They sit there like nubs. And so the big question is, why aren't we firing about half of those people?
We, in the House, when we tried to cut the budget, we did eliminate a lot of those federal positions and try to bring them in, but then it didn't fly in the Senate, so we weren't able to do that. One of the bills that I co-sponsored to stop the sequestration, this $500 billion extra cut that's going to come to defense in the first part of January if we don't stop it. But it does take pay for the first year of sequestration by not rehiring federal employees that are leave through attrition. It doesn't call for the firing at that point, but as they leave, retire, not, and we can pay, we can save enough money just by not doing that for 1 year to, that was 10 years, over 10 years to pay for
it. You're going to have to get rid of the civil service rules because you cannot, for anything, fire a government employee. They can come to work drunk, they can dirty or rape somebody, and there's somebody that'll protect them. I think that's where your biggest problem is. Civil service just lines up and they just won't fire a person. There's nothing they can do that you will fire them for.
That's dangerous.
I'm a retired civil service worker, and I can tell you when Clinton had that 3-week furlough, the government lost $60 million, but the taxpayers saved $65 million. So there is a cost savings there. As far as Harry Reid, his election comes up in 2014. The best way to get rid of Harry Reid is to find out who's running against him and support them from another state. That's how some, in 2010, that's how some conservatives actually got into office, because they were looking to get rid of the establishment. And a lot of the candidates are getting support outside the state they are living in. Just a comment.
Hey, Ken.
Another thing, you're talking about getting rid of Harry Reid, which would be beautiful, and all that. The way we can get a handle on a lot of this is term limitation. You know, you have only four farmers on it. You know, we get to the point where in all of Congress, there's very few people that have ever, and I don't mean this wrong, that have ever worked a day in their life.
Right.
They've either gone straight from the military and to politics, or straight from college and to politics, and they can talk about being in touch with the common man.
There are some bills out there with some proposals I'm looking at for term limits. And so I think, you know, I get a lot of support from looking at serious.